my introduction. Today I have chosen this topic, work hard and smart work, because in this age of internet, what is most important is everything is moving very fast. In fact, we are talking in terms of smartphone, smart city, smart village, smart person, smart entrepreneur, smart corporate body, everything smart. So work also cannot remain, I don't think, that anything but smart. So I took up this subject feeling that all of us might have undergone some moments sometime at some point of time, some moments like this, that I have put in a lot of work, lot of hard work, but at the same time I have not got the desired results. This might have been the case with everybody, with me. Again, hello.
Hello, Pradeep.
Hello.
Sir. Yes, sir, Pradeep. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You are
am audible? I audible?
Yeah. Yes. Please continue, sir. Yeah.
Yes. Thanks. So, I think all of us must have undergone this period of some moments of desperation in life, that even though you have put in a lot of hard work, in spite of that, you might not have got the desired result. Also, we sometimes do not receive adequate accolade, adequate appreciation, adequate recognition for which we suffer mentally. So I feel that sometimes we start blaming the organization, blaming the boss, blaming the system, blaming everybody, the environment, except ourselves. We don't blame ourselves. We think that we are probably right, and the organization has not taken note of the fact that I have put in so much of hard work and I deserve something. So the due has not been given to me. But in fact, that is always, I feel, that something very extra in life which has to be done. What is that extra? What is that extra is exactly what we are going to discuss today in this hard work versus smart work. I think so far it's audible. I am audible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thanks. Now, in between, I will be asking, because there is a lot of disturbances, interruptions because of this internet disconnection. Now, before we go to the presentation, I would like all of you to recollect those days, those hard days of our student life. All of us, when we were student, in fact, we had a lot of prescriptions from our parents, from guardians, even from teachers, that work hard and you have to toil, say, for 12 hours, 10 hours a day, study very hard. You have to burn midnight oil, all like that. But there will be very few counsels like that, think also out of box. That is very rare. So you might have seen that there are two categories of people, two categories of students. One category, there are students, those who work hard, toil 10, 12 hours per day, but somehow just extraordinary. Whereas there are very few students who can beat others by simple, careful planning. What do? They usually, the whole year, they are very attentive in the class, so that they have got a very good grasp of the various subject topics. And daily they put in some 2-3 hours. But before the D-day comes, the exam comes, say 3-4 months before, they make careful planning. They choose their subjects, they select questions, they prepare their notes, and also make very summary notes, because they know these summary notes, they will be very helpful on the eve of the exam. So these are you may not say that these are hard work, but these are definitely smart work they are doing. And because of that, they sometimes top this class, sometimes do something very extraordinary, and they are called the brilliant boys. So this distinction, whatever we have felt in our student life, and that distinction is now becoming very glaring. And today, that's why I have taken up this subject, smart work versus hard work. Now, coming to my presentation itself, the very first slide, you are seeing Ganesh ji here in my first slide, must be thinking that probably Ganesh ji is Agra Pujya. That is why I have put Ganesh ji on my first slide. Maybe that is there in this, that today for my topic, Ganesh ji is more relevant. You might have known in mythology this story, particularly regarding Ganesh ji and Kartikeya. And when Shiva and Parvati, they were taking rest in Kailas mountain, one day sage Narad came to them and told them that he has got a mango from Lord Brahma. He handed over the mango to Lord Shiva and told him to hand over this to one of his boys. Now, both Shiva and Parvati, they were in a dilemma. They thought that whom should they hand over this particular mango to? Because given the fact that there is a certain sibling rivalry between the two, they did not want to dissatisfy anybody. That's why they called for a challenge. They set up a competition between them, told both of them that you go and circle around the whole world thrice. And one who would come back quickly, very fast, and he will be rewarded with this mango. So immediately Kartikeya, he zoomed off. Without wasting a single moment, he zoomed off. And of course, on the way, Kartikeya could feel that probably Ganesh ji is always moving ahead of him. He could have that feeling. But Kartikeya, anyhow, he managed to circle around the world. Whereas Ganesh ji thought that he is plump, he has got a very rotund body, and he has got a vehicle, you know, mouse. So it's not possible for him to move around the world thrice. So what he did, he requested both Shiva and Parvati to sit down, and he circled around Shiva and Parvati. So when after circling around Shiva and Parvati three times, Ganesh ji told them that give me the mango, I deserve it because I have already moved around the world. How is it? You have not gone? No, so, because you, both of you are really more than the whole world to me. So that is why I think that I deserve this mango. I have already encircled the world thrice. So Lord Shiva and Parvati, they were pleased with the wit, and they handed over the gift to Ganesh ji. Now, that is how Ganesh ji outsmarted Kartikeya and beat him in this challenge to win the race around the world. That is my first slide. I am going to my second slide. I have given initially some slides just to make very much comfortable with the very idea that what is really smart work. Now, I have taken another story from Akbar and Birbal. One day, Akbar was sitting in his Mahal palace, and when he was looking outside, he could see that a lot of travelers, they are moving on camel's back. So he asked one of his sardars to go and inquire who they are. Sardar went out and again came back and told King Akbar that they are sellers. Now, what they are selling? Again, Sardar had to run and come back with the reply that they are selling dates. Where from they are? Again asked King. Again Sardar went. Again, he came back and told that they are from Afghanistan. So, disgusted, King Akbar called for Birbal and sent him to find out what is actually happening, who are they. So, King Birbal went there, found out, and came back with a gift in his hand. He told King Akbar, Your Majesty, actually they are the sellers from Afghanistan and they are going to Lucknow to sell dates. And when I told them that His Majesty was inquiring about all of you, then they handed over this gift, and this gift is for Your Majesty and please accept. So this is how actually Birbal satisfied. With his complete and comprehensive answer, he satisfied his boss. So, fully understanding the boss and pleasing him is really a smart act. Smart act. Now, we have got another story also. You must have, in our childhood days, we all know about this thirsty crow. In the very first picture, you can see that the crow is putting the pebbles in the pitcher so that the water level in the pitcher should come up, and then he will drink water and fly away. And we thought at that time it's really a smart act. These days we can still, I have shown it in the second picture, that is, the crow is just sipping the water by taking a straw. So, you just see, the idea is that you can achieve the goal even with less effort and less time. When you are taking less time and taking less effort to reach the goal, you are doing a smart act. Now, all these stories I have taken from mythology or from history, whatever. But even from the daily life situation, if you see, these things are still there. I can give you another picture here when somebody is carrying the heavy load in his back, and whereas the other one is just carrying the load in a cart, and here the wheel is doing the trick. So here also we are seeing the case of less effort and less time, and why unnecessarily one would do the so much of physical exercise and will adjust himself when there is a choice. So, and that is why you have to use tools sometimes. These days you have to use technology. Say, without a PC, without a smartphone, these are all tools. Without taking those things into your hand, you cannot achieve anything. So, tools should be handy. They should be updated. They should be kept in good shape so that you can make use of the tools to make less effort and take less time to achieve a goal. I have another slide here. Here, NASA, National Administration of Space Administration of United States, NASA of United States, while they launched their astronauts to space, they found that the plane will not be working in zero gravity there. So what did they do? They started researching about that, and it took them at least one decade and $12 million. They had to invest that much of money to develop a pen to work in space. But in contrast, you see that the Russians, what they had to do? They simply used pencils. So they are smart, because pencil will definitely work in zero gravity. I am not saying that what US did, that was not required. In long term, that was required. Definitely, you have to do research. You have to find out that why the pain did not work, and under what circumstances the pain will work. All these things you will have to see. But in the short term, Russians definitely were way ahead of the Americans. Now, finally, I have come to this picture. This is about a Japanese company, soap company. A Japanese soap company which was producing soaps one day received a complaint from a valued customer that he has received an empty box without any cake, without any soap inside. After receiving this complaint, immediately they responded. The company sent them a box with soap, and also at the same time sent a letter of apology. At the same time, the company wanted to go deep into it to find out why there was an empty box. Company engaged the engineers there. The engineers also tried to see the whole processes, the manufacturing process, what happened, and they could see the assembly line. They detected there that what is happening, that there is in the assembly line, that there is a machine which is putting the cake inside the box. Now, in every 10,000 cases after that, there is some synchronization problem of timing for which the machine is not able to pick up the soap and put it in the box, for which a box is moving empty, going ahead empty. To solve this problem, they had to brainstorm, and finally they found out that now we will have to install one X-ray attached to a monitor, and we have to engage two skilled workers so that to detect those empty boxes. Whenever there will be the empty box, it will be detected by the X-ray attached to the monitor. And after that, these two skilled workers who will be standing there always, they will have to take out that empty box. Now, after that, the company wanted to felicitate the engineers. In that felicitation, the engineers explained that how smartly they have discovered this thing and they have solved the problem. At that time, a very small worker stood up and told that we could have solved it in a different way also, in a very simple way. How? Now, we could have put one industrial fan pointed to the assembly line and along with a blower, so that the blower would have blown away the empty boxes from the assembly line. Then the engineers thought that, yes, it's a really good idea, very good idea. We have never thought of it. And they have spent already lakhs of rupees, whereas it doesn't require that much of investment. So they were very happy. So the worker was also felicitated there. And somehow they could get over the problem.